Let us start now. I have explained you in great detail about the use of model contactors for the identification of rate controlling step. You are familiar with this table. Yeah. So, just to recapitulate, we try to understand the rate controlling step, let it be gas liquid or liquid liquid or solid liquid or solid gas or liquid liquid. We use model contactors. And model contactors have two specific characteristic features. One is the interfacial area between the phases is known, and secondly, there is always a facility of changing mass transfer coefficient, let it be liquid liquid or solid gas. Stirred cell I explained in detail, and other model contactors like wetted wall column, laminar jet reactor, or wetted sphere column, or rotating disc contactor. These I explained to you, where is the known interfacial area and what is the method by which mass transfer coefficient can be changed. So I explained to you rotating drum, wetted wall column, wetted sphere column, the laminar jet apparatus and stirred reactor. All these were for either gas liquid or liquid liquid system. If there are two immiscible liquid phases, then with the help of stirred contactor, the stirred cell, which I explained in great detail, then this interface will not be gas liquid. This will be liquid-liquid interface. And I had drawn on the board, then there will be impeller like this. Impeller like this is also permissible. The only part is this may create waves on the surface. Therefore, it is a good idea to have a paddle type of impeller. But the entire sequence remains the same. Very slow reactions take hours. Slow reactions take several minutes. Fast reactions take several seconds to few minutes, and instantaneous reactions take few to several seconds. So if we actually carry out the reaction with whatever gas liquid or liquid liquid or solid liquid system is given to us, we try to find out time required for 50% conversion. If it is several hours, approximately, of course. So we know whether we are closer to one or between one and two, that it will tell, or between two and three or three and four. So this is the first test. Then we see the effect of impeller speed. There is no effect of impeller speed in very slow reaction, whereas in all other regimes, there is an effect of impeller speed. In third regime also there is no effect of impeller speed. Only in second and fourth there is effect of. So depending upon time required for 50% conversion, suppose it is several minutes, then it will be between one first and second of that order. And then we try to bring it to the first regime. If it takes few minutes to several seconds, then it must be somewhere third and fourth, and the kinetic rate constant K2 or KMN and orders of reaction M and N, they prevail only in regime 1 and regime 3. So by changing this, we discussed in great detail that how to bring, if it is in between first and second, then how to bring it in second. If it is between second and third, then how to bring it in the third. And if it is between third and fourth, how to bring it in the third. Having done that, we saw many other characteristic features. That is, if the overall reaction is speed dependent, if it is independent of S star, then it must be fourth. If it is independent of B naught, then it must be the second. And many such identifying features. You have understood all of them, no, at that time? I need not repeat. So all the contactors which were shown to you, the model contactors, these were for fluid-fluid systems, either gas-liquid or liquid-liquid. When it is solid gas or solid liquid, then one interesting part is the solids we take with known size distribution for reaction. We measure the size distribution with the help of particle size analyzer, and area is known. And therefore, the job of model contactor, it becomes very simple. And let me show you some model contactors for solid-fluid reactions. Let me try without the mic. Is it okay, backside? Are you able to hear? Right. So, these are model contactors for solid fluid. The Carberry reactor is, imagine a flat blade turbine impeller. Okay. Imagine flat blade. But all these surfaces, if you see very closely, then these are screens, right, with solid fraction of 5% and open area of 95%. So all this is flat turbines, these are pitch blade turbines, and this is also a sort of a flat turbine. And inside this basket, the solid particles are kept. I have already told you that for solid fluid reactions, the solid surface is known. So one requirement of model contactor is already satisfied. Right? And the now how to change mass transfer coefficient? So it becomes so simple, right? So let it be very slow or fast or very fast. There can be instantaneous reaction, there can be film reaction, and I had drawn concentration profiles last time where the B naught can come to the solid fluid interface, or the solid phase may have solubility, and then the concentration profile can be other way around. Do you have all those profiles on here? Otherwise, I don't mind drawing them again. Do you have those profiles? And saturation concentration of solid, let it call it as C star. So this is very slow. So this is a reaction plane. C star goes to zero. B naught goes to zero. So this total thickness is delta, whereas reaction plane is lambda. So that entire table which we had constructed for gas liquid, we can write in very slow reaction, K instead of Mn, if it is that is reserved for gas liquid, we can write here, say xy. Or we can continue to keep Mn, so Kmn, C star raised to m, B naught raised to n, and then the holdup of solid particles is epsilon s. All right? So accordingly, the reaction will happen. Here, the mass transfer coefficient is between solid and fluid, and we write Ksl, Ap, particles, this is the mass transfer coefficient, into C star minus zero. Here we write, of course, Kmn. C star raised to m, B naught raised to n. And multiplied by now epsilon s, the solid phase. If it is, then the rate is A into C star diffusive 2 upon m plus 1 Kmn C star raised to m and if we come here then it is Ksl Ap into C star 1 plus B naught upon ZC star. You can quickly derive the conditions to be satisfied and you can also write the rates in between first and second, second and third. Can I assume that? You can write in between, right? And you have completely understood how to identify the controlling step? Yes? This is a very, very important subject which I am declaring that it is complete. But prior to making that statement, I'll be very pleased to answer any question. Yeah.
How do we incorporate a catalyst in this? Because solid may not be a reactant. A liquid-liquid reaction in case of catalyst.
That subject I will teach. I'll teach that subject. So that we will call it as, this is gas liquid solid reactions where solids participate in the reaction. So we will take up gas liquid solid reactions where solids act as a catalyst. Okay. Let me make one exact statement and then you tell me whether it is understood or not. In the reactor, let it be stirred tank reactor or any other reactor, many of them I have explained in the class, locally there will be certain epsilon G, epsilon L or epsilon S, locally. Locally there will be partial pressure of gas. Locally there will be some concentration of B naught. Locally there will be certain temperature. Locally there will be certain pressure. So when these values are locally known, at that point, knowing the conditions under which a particular regime is satisfied, we can write for this case, we can calculate root M, we can calculate the enhancement factor, we can see whether mass transfer coefficient is much greater than reaction, or mass transfer rate is much less than. So for those conditions at that point, we can find the rate controlling step and we can write the overall rate of reaction. This is the statement I'm making. Is this understood? At some other location, there will be another set of partial pressure, temperature, etc. We find it separately, and then in the entire reactor, at every point we know the performance, and then we are now ready to start with step three. That is how to do step of the process design, with which I'm going to start now. But I want to confirm again and again that depending upon local conditions, with the help of model contactor, you have already established for given set of conditions, you know what is the controlling step and how to estimate overall rate of reaction, right? Okay. So here we change KSL with the help of impeller speed, and this is Carberry. He was a professor in MIT, and then approximately 50 years ago, he incorporated Carberry reactor in the research in MIT. Next. Is that all? Anyway, let me draw a few reactors, a few model contactors for you. Can we close this temporarily? Or you can put book in front of that. The simplest model contactor is take a pipe, all right, and have some differential volume with screens on both the sides and put particles of known size. Make a fixed bed. So whether it is gas liquid reaction or solid liquid reaction, there is a possibility of changing volumetric flow rate. So we can change the particle size, we can change the amount of solid loading here, and we can change the flow rate. All right. So with change in flow rate, the KSL will change. All right. So if it changes with KSL, then if it is definitely not in regime 1 or not in regime 3, it is in 2 or in 4. If it depends upon now C star, then we know it is not in 4, correct? Whereas if it is independent of B naught, then it is not in regime 2. So many times, the volumetric flow rate, the range over which we can change, in some of the cases, there may be limitations. Therefore, we try to provide a recycle stream. So this is a recycle. So this is another model contactor which can be easily constructed, and we need not have Carberry reactor or a Bertie reactor, which I'm going to explain a few minutes from now. So this becomes a model contactor. We just want two things, non-interfacial area and methodology to change mass transfer coefficient. So this is very easy way to change. If the net flow is kept constant and we keep on changing the recycle, we can keep valve in the recycle line and flow rate can be changed. That will change the extent of conversion and overall rate of reaction, and that overall rate of reaction we can examine whether it varies with volumetric flow rate, whether it varies with particle size, with particle loading, and with temperature. All those exercises we do and try to find out the rate constant, M, N, activation energy, and all these points. One more reactor, that is a Bertie reactor. One point I would like to tell you, when you see either Carberry reactor or Bertie reactor, you will realize that you could have also invented. Correct, no? Huh? So my suggestion to you is have a lot of confidence. We can also do it. We can also do it. Just think about it, and what exactly is required is some level of confidence, and on the basis of confidence, do some experiments, and after doing experiments, and after doing experiments with known model contactors, then try to establish your own procedure, right? I had decided not to speak in advisory mode because it is getting recorded and it is going to go to YouTube. I was going to eliminate, but I will tell the right people to delete this portion, whatever advising I'm in between. Otherwise, it will go to the, or it may be even good idea. I'll decide. So Bertie reactor is again a small 1 liter reactor. Have you understood the elevation and the plan view? That there is a annular basket made up of the wire gauze, completely made up of wire gauze, where wire gauze, the metal occupies only 5% or less than 5%. It is open on all the sides. And in this, impeller is provided, which is a axial flow impeller, so that it creates flows downward in the central region and upward in the solid phase. By the way, the solid fluid model contactors which I am explaining to you, these are useful for both, where solids are reacting and where solid is a catalyst. That catalyst part we will discuss little later. So here the flow takes a turn because of the downflow impeller. Again, we fill this annular basket with the help of particles of known size. We can change the particle size because of which the interfacial area changes. That is, even one shade better than fluid-fluid contactors, that in fluid-fluid case, changing the bubble size distribution is not that easy. Whereas we can take 3 mm particles, 2 mm particles, 1 mm particles, 500 micron particles, 100 micron particles, whatever we wish to have, and see the effect of interfacial area, in addition to the mass transfer coefficient, which varies because of the impeller speed, correct? And otherwise, the theory remains the same. So that way, this overall subject is straightforward. I first of all taught you the theory of mass transfer with chemical reaction, that is very slow, how the reaction occurs completely in the bulk and no reaction occurs in the film, the mass transfer controlled, where the mass transfer coefficient is much less than the rate of chemical reaction, no reaction occurs in the film, but the dissolved concentration of either A or C is practically zero. Same is the case for fast reaction. The concentration of A or C is zero in the bulk liquid. The only difference is in second regime, all A comes to the bulk and reacts there. And since fast reaction occurs, the concentration is zero. Whereas in regime 3, all the reaction occurs in the film and no A or C enters the bulk. Finally, whenever there is instantaneous reaction, instantaneous means whenever A and B or C and B meet each other, the reaction is complete. That is instantaneous. And therefore, in place of reaction volume, we have reaction plane, right? And beyond the reaction plane, the other reactant, B does not cross this plane, C does not cross this plane. And we derived equation for this also. And we also derived in great detail the conditions under which each regime is satisfied. So with this theory of heat and mass heat transfer basically, mass transfer, let me see whether I'm able to teach you, but it is a good idea. So with this theory, then with the help of model contactor, that also explained in detail, how to get the rate controlling step for a given set of parameters and how to calculate the overall rate depending upon whatever is the local partial pressure, etc. It may clearly be in 1, clearly in 2, clearly in 3 at some locations, but it is not mandatory. It can be somewhere in between. At the bottom, where there is lot of partial pressure, it is likely that it is in the third regime. At the top, where most of the gas is completely consumed, 99% or 99.5%, at the top of the reactor, it may be in the first regime. Right? But all this information we know much before we start the design, right? No? We would have done sufficient number of experiments. So those BTEC and BCHEMIN students, those who are working together for their project, I think for their design, now I'm going to start the design exercise, how to get the actual dimensions of the equipment. And as far as your class is concerned, I think I'm supposed to restrict it to stirred tank reactors. And then for third year, I will teach all the equipment. Any question at this stage? Otherwise, I'll begin with process design. Okay? Array. The other way around also, I promised you I will draw. This I think I had drawn last time. So like liquid-liquid reactions, I discussed that part in great detail in the class, that first we need to understand the phase in which reaction occurs, right? So by changing the relative proportions of liquid, by changing impeller speeds in individual phases, and by analyzing the products in each phase, we saw that how we can. But in this case, how do we find out whether the solid is dissolving and reacting, or the B naught is coming to the surface and reaction is occurring on the surface? How to find that? In these cases, more or less, the C does not have much solubility, so that the B has to come right up to the interface in that case. Say, for example, very recently, I studied, as you know, I'm working in atomic energy. So whenever the fuel, we declare that fuel is spent, the energy, as you know, is released because of fission reaction. And uranium fission releases energy, and that energy is picked up by water at high pressure, and whatever is the saturation temperature, which is 272, then that steam goes for a turbine for generating electricity. After condensation, the water comes back and it flows over. So the fuel is in the form of vertical rods. The fuel is, so imagine one pipe which is 100 millimeter diameter, in which there are 5 millimeter diameter, say 50 pins of uranium, correct? And in this pipe, the fission reaction occurs within the rod, and in the pipe, water is passed. And all that fission reaction exothermic heat, that heat is picked up by water. Initially, water gets preheated up to boiling point. Then it boils. Then we have two-phase flow. Then two-phase flow, first of all, the vapor phase, the steam is in the form of bubbles. Then there is a slug flow, followed by there is an annular flow. And all that gas-liquid mixture goes to steam drum, where steam is separated from water, steam goes for a turbine, and water comes back. Whatever water is converted into steam, that much water is added into the loop so that the material balance of the loop is complete, right? What I was telling you was, these pins, when we say that they are exhausted, means the rate of fission reaction goes down below a certain level. If we are designing, say, 500 megawatt reactor, it may run plus minus 10%, 550 megawatt, 450 megawatt. So below 450 megawatt, then we say that soon the fuel rods are going to get exhausted. The reactor is stopped. It takes 1 year or even more. All these rods are removed, and these rods are chopped into pieces, correct? And it is very, very interesting. The uranium rods will have a certain price of uranium. But when we say that it is exhausted, most of it, lot of it, gets converted to plutonium, which is even more expensive, right? And lot of lanthanides and actinides, and all of them have lot of value, much more than even plutonium. So separating all these actinides and lanthanides, then entire chemical engineering is very useful. First of all, what is done? These pieces are dissolved in nitric acid, in all the cases. Let it be any fuel, plutonium fuel or uranium fuel or any other fuel. First of all, it is dissolved in nitric acid, and we get respective nitrates. Why this subject has come, that some solids have limited solubility or no solubility in the liquid phase. So these rods, the rod pieces of either uranium or plutonium or mixture of uranium and plutonium, they have practically no solubility in nitric acid. So nitric acid from the bulk, it reaches the surface and chemical reaction occurs on the surface. So this is of the second type. I had a lot of opportunities to design dissolution of golden ornaments for recovering silver or gold. Designed a big plant which was in Devnar in late 70s, early 80s, which is now shifted to Api. Point is, not copper, not gold, not uranium, not plutonium. The solid solubility in liquid is limited in all these cases. That is the point, correct? There are many other cases where solids have solubility, positively solids have solubility, and those cases can be discussed. I think I have circulated examples of industrial importance to all of you. Is that right? Gas liquid, 50 examples. Liquid, 30 examples. Solid liquid, gas liquid, solid, where solids undergo chemical reaction, another 50 examples. Where solid acts as a catalyst, another 30 examples. Have you received it? None. So is the email is a block email, no? Okay. So you will get all these examples of industrial export. Recently, I had an opportunity to design one plant, which I think I mentioned sometime back to you. The copper-based agrochemical, that is a fungicide, in France. And copper was to be dissolved in ammonical solution almost 30 to 35 tons per day. And to this class, I have not explained, but third year I have explained in greater detail the reactor called moving bed reactor. See, whenever all these particles dissolve, eventually, if the particle is initially 3 millimeters, after dissolving, nothing. Solids are nothing. So we take a vertical column, and there is a solid particles. And upflow, say in this case, the upflow is of nitric acid. And the chemical reaction occurs, the solid dissolution occurs. And the solid level, as the dissolution occurs, the solid level goes down. Correct? It collapses. And at the top, level is maintained by addition of the fresh quantity of solids. So this is called, because of reaction, the solid phase is collapsing. As a result, the reactor is called moving bed reactor, right? Moving bed reactor. So there is a, as far as solids are concerned, there is a dead end. At the other end, there is no outlet for solids. That is called a dead end system. At the inlet, we have fresh quantity of solid, and from top to bottom, we have the entire particle size distribution. If it is 3 mm at the top, then 0 mm at the bottom. So this is the moving bed reactor. And because of that, at every point, interfacial area is different. And particle size is different, therefore KL is different. And then we need to take into account what exactly is the local regime of operation and how to determine the overall rate of reaction at that particular point. All right. I wanted to emphasize that part. I can see gold and platinum, I can give very, very attractive names, but as far as chemical engineering is concerned, it is C-star. All right. Whatever is the solubility, that is, let it be anything. So try to understand, when you understand the theory, then the after understanding theory, you need to do some practice also. So it is a good opportunity that you BTEC and BCom Eng students are together. So try to do experiments in this manner. Try to design approximately 40 experiments so that you can really design a stirred tank reactor. And that particular part of designing stirred tank reactor, now I'm going to start. And for this class, I'm going to teach only stirred tank reactors, nothing else. All the reactors that design, I'll teach third year students. I don't remember, but did I solve one example where there was a homogeneous reaction, and then we tried to remove heat via jacket, then we provided baffle in the jacket, then we provided limpet coil, then we saw that the exothermic heat of reaction we enhanced, therefore we provided a single coil and double coil and all the possibilities. We saw that? You remember that? Okay. Let me take one more example of homogeneous reaction. Anyway, it will be an additional example. Let me go to multiphase reactions, stirred tank reactor for multiphase reactions. Let it be gas liquid, liquid liquid, solid liquid, any one of the reactions. Before starting teaching you the design of multiphase reactor, but multiphase reactor, only stirred tank reactor, it is very, the easiest subject that you would have learned in your life. You can relax completely, but give all your attention to me. why I said that was, in stirred tanks, the liquid phase, solid phase, and gas phase, all of them are completely backmixed. All right. So the liquid concentration at any point within the stirred tank is equal to the outlet concentration. So suppose I write as B naught out, and write this as B naught in. And the gas is coming in. And gas is leaving out. Maybe I can. When you started the design, you knew what is the information you knew. Say, for example, let us take the case of chlorination of toluene to get benzyl chloride. Design a reactor for manufacture of 50 tons per day of benzyl chloride. That is the title. Okay. Now, what is the starting point? Fortunately, in this case, chlorine is known, toluene is known, molecule is known, and toluene plus chlorine, chemical reactions are also known. The substitution of ring hydrogen is very difficult. What we get is the side chain CH3. One hydrogen is replaced, which we get CH2Cl, we get CHCl2, and we get CCl3. Right? So benzyl chloride, benzyl chloride, and benzotrichloride. By the way, this is the reactor I designed the first in my life in 1973. To begin with, a batch reactor, and then continuous reactor. So I'm going to teach you both the design of batch reactor as well as continuous reactor. Right? I'll do that continuous first, and then I will go to the batch reactor. So now this much is known. Chlorine reacts with toluene and gives, say, product is benzyl chloride. We are interested in benzyl chloride. We are not interested in benzyl chloride. So this is a reaction. If you wish to call this as A, then you get CH2Cl. Of course, at every stage, as you would have realized, HCl is liberated. All right. So if chlorine is, where that reactor has gone? Yeah, it's there. If chlorine is passed here, and if the chlorine reacts completely, if it all reacts completely, then one chlorine reaction, equivalently, one mole of HCl is liberated, correct? So one mole of chlorine, if only first reaction occurs, at the outlet it is HCl. If 99% reaction occurs, then at the outlet 1% is chlorine and 99% is HCl. Accordingly, the partial pressure gets decided. So As far as exercise is concerned, did I say 50 tons per day? 50 tons per day. Toluene is known, chlorine is known. How to get them in the laboratory is known. Now, how to begin? 50 tons per day, I want benzyl chloride, which also means I don't want benzyl chloride. I don't want benzotrichloride. In reality, we can maximize. Obviously, some quantity of benzyl chloride, we can control perhaps benzotrichloride, but some very, very, very small quantity of benzotrichloride also gets formed. But let us assume that we can restrict it A to B. Now, problem is known, chemicals are known. How to begin? Step one, that is qualitative description of all reactors, their classification, how to design this reactor against that reactor, and what are the relative merits. As far as this class is concerned, there is no discussion. We want to design only stirred tanks. Very simple, very simple. Any answer? How to begin? Kinetic study, yeah. But I think let it come vibrantly from the entire class. We discussed in great detail two times how to find rate controlling step and overall rate of reaction. Now we pick up stirred cell, there is a chlorine, there is a toluene, and we carry out reactions. First of all, for 50% conversion, let us see whether several hours to few hours are required, whether several minutes are required, few minutes are required, or several seconds are required. Correct? Are you getting me? Let us order a cup of tea now. Yes? Yeah, yeah. So somebody should take lead. Take lead and order. No, you are not moving mainly because you are so much interested in learning. If you go for the canteen, you will lose 3-4 minutes. Right? Today, there is no money in my pocket. So we'll do some editing. Yeah? Later on, we'll do some editing. So take stirred cell. Maybe 10 centimeter diameter. Interface is known. In the gas phase, there is chlorine. In the gas phase, there is an impeller. In the liquid phase, also there is an impeller. We keep the speed in gas phase in such a way that there is no gas side resistance, right? Or otherwise, what we can do is pass chlorine at such a flow rate that very limited conversion of chlorine happens so that the chlorine is practically pure in the gas phase. So there is no question of gas side resistance. But under these conditions, then how to change A star? Because we need to change partial pressure. So how to do that? We need to change partial pressure. If HCl was getting liberated, then the relative proportion of HCl and chlorine, if we pass less chlorine, same quantity of chlorine gets reacted, and the HCl-chlorine mixture at the outlet is different, and we can change the partial pressure. The partial pressure in this case, I want answer. How to change partial pressure of chlorine or the value of A star, which is partial pressure multiplied by Henry's coefficient. 50 rupees. One who gives good answer, 50 rupees. Today only promises. Now we are not diluting because we don't want gas side resistance, pure chlorine. Take this as a strategy. That is also a good strategy. That is dilute it with nitrogen. And we can do from 2%, 5%, 10%, 50%, whatever we want we can do. We can get partial pressure and we can get variety of A star. But we have taken a decision. Huh. Uh-huh. See, quantity is there in the gas space. The quantity is there. We are saying partial pressure of chlorine. There will be product HCl coming out, but the rate at which we are passing chlorine is, say, 50 times greater than the rate of generation of HCl. Now we want to change the partial pressure in the gas space. Now we want to change the partial pressure of chlorine in the gas space. Let us discuss this part. Because I have already told you that design of stirred reactors is very easy. Let it be in any regime of operation. Once we have understood how to calculate the overall rate of reaction, which I will repeat, of course, again and again I will repeat till you get the confidence. And you solve the examples. You solve the examples, yeah. How to change partial pressure? Change temperature. What will happen because of change in temperature? Henry's coefficient will change. So this is fair answer. Suppose I want good answer. You know the answer, yeah. Go ahead. We want to change the partial pressure. I had decided to complete the course of stirred tank reactor design today, but it doesn't matter if we meet once more. We'll design the reactor with discussion. How to change partial pressure? Suppose we control, right? And we stop it. In an ultimate case, we can stop it, no? What will happen? Pressure will increase. And chlorine is pure. So increase in pressure, total pressure, what will happen to partial pressure? So whenever, now you must have realized it was so simple and you lost 50 rupees individually. Whenever gas is pure, total pressure is partial pressure. Simple, no? Right. But still I'll give you 50%. We can change the impeller speed. We want change in A star. A star means the saturation concentration of A in the liquid phase. By changing impeller speed, actual dissolved concentration can change. If it is in first regime, it will be A star. If you increase the rate, we can bring A naught is equal to zero. By changing the speed, we can adjust the conditions in such a way that all the reaction is complete in the film, but all these changes are in A naught. A star is a physical property of that gas and that liquid. It is the saturation solubility. The Henry's coefficient for toluene and chlorine is a known value. It is a thermodynamic property and it cannot be changed. And it is the saturation concentration is always partial pressure multiplied by Henry's coefficient. Henry's coefficient is a is a thermodynamic property, but partial pressure can be changed. So we can keep pressure 1 atmosphere, 2 atmospheres, 10 atmospheres, or we can keep 0.5 atmosphere, 0.1 atmosphere, and we can vary a star over a wide range. Correct? That can be done. B naught, that is Toluene. So how to change B naught? That is one good idea. Another idea, as the reaction proceeds, anyway toluene is getting converted to benzyl chloride. Whenever it is 50-50%, then the concentration is half. Correct? So the concentration of B can be changed, concentration of A can be changed, the temperature can be changed, partial pressure can be changed. Now how do we find out, how do we go further? The first one is, we try to understand order of magnitude of rate of chemical reaction. And therefore, we pass chlorine at any rate and try to, we just want whether it takes, it gets finished in few seconds or several hours. Okay. Then we know whether to bring this reaction in regime 1 or regime 3. Accordingly, we know now with the help of KL, that is the impeller speed, with the values of A star and B naught, how to bring it in either regime 1 or regime 3. We try to get values of M and N. We try to get values of rate constant, KMN. Perform the experiment at variety of temperatures and try to get activation energy. Now this is done as a starting point before the design. Right now the design is happening about the ozonolysis of waste stream. As you know, some of the effluents, they cannot be oxidized biologically. They are very stringent molecules as far as oxidation is concerned. But ozone as an oxidizing agent is very reactive. So ozone, which is 2% in oxygen, is passed through, say, phenol is one of such compounds where it cannot be oxidized easily, or chlorophenols or nitrophenols or naphthals or the chemicals in that particular family. So ozonolysis will happen. So if we are asked to do ozonolysis, then also we'll go the step, this particular step is identical, exactly identical. If you're asked to do hydrogenation, the same thing. If it is oxidation of paraxylene to terthalic acid, we do the same thing. Instead of toluene, we take xylene. And instead of chlorine, we take oxygen. We can take pure oxygen. We can take 21% oxygen. We can do it at total pressure of 10 atmospheres, 20 atmospheres, 50 atmospheres, right? So take any case out of the 50 examples given to you of industrial importance, and for all those cases, the common procedure and mandatory procedure is to understand what exactly is the kinetics of the reaction, right? Having done that, what is the next step in the design? 50 tons per day of product. What is the product molecular weight? What is the answer? Kilomoles per day. Convert into second. Check again. So it can be in first regime, it can be in second, third, or fourth, or in between. But what can be the overall procedure? If we write since it is completely back mixed, whatever is a star at any location is the value of partial pressure at the outlet. And whatever is B naught out, the concentration, which is same throughout. So A star and B naught are the same. So we want overall, the overall rate which is say some rate R. The volumetric rate of reaction it depends upon the regime of operation. So we have been writing is equal to RAA. And this is kilomoles per meter cube second. And volume of the reactor now, as an engineer, we face some issues which are very, very common. All right. Should we assume 95% conversion? 97, 99, 99.9? What should be the liquid phase conversion? How much chlorine we should pass? 2% excess? 10% excess? 100% excess, because nobody is going to guide you. This will be your personal selection. Absolutely nobody is going to. But what are the criteria? Suppose we select 95% conversion, this means 95% of the toluene gets reacted, and at the outlet we have 5% toluene and 95% benzyl chloride. What can be the decision? What is a good decision? Whenever there is unreacted toluene, we need to have distillation column separate from each other. So depending upon the purity which the market acceptability is there, say 99.9% pure benzyl chloride, it sells with 0.1%, that is 1000 ppm of toluene, is acceptable. Then better produce that directly, don't have another equipment. All right. So this is one decision, one possibility of decision. So 99.9% conversion is one possibility. Whereas with respect to chlorine, what is the decision that we should have? The absorption should occur. So whether we should add stoichiometrically or excess. Right. Why we should add excess? This the answer is correct. Whatever is being discussed internally, that answer is correct. So if all the chlorine reacts, outlet chlorine is zero, which is same as anywhere in the equipment, the partial pressure is zero, therefore A star is also zero, and therefore rate is also zero. Right? So that is not acceptable. But then what is acceptable? 1% excess, 2% excess, 5% excess? First thing that we should decide, if there is an excess, what is going to happen with that excess chlorine which will come out of the reactor with HCl? Right? What will happen to that? And if only HCl comes, it is normally scrubbed with water to get 30% HCl solution. If there is additional chlorine, what will happen? What will happen? This we need to think first. The second part is, suppose we want to decide any excess. Excess means money, no? If we pass 10% excess, the chlorine in early 1980, when I designed this reactor, it was 50 paisa kilo at that time. Right. But at that time, all the monies were of this order. Even the overall turnover, the profit was also of this order. The total company after 50 tons per day, the turnover was 5 crores. And the profit was less than 1 crore. So the order sum. So the whatever is the excess, there may be a possibility to scrub this mixture of chlorine and HCl, first of all through caustic, so that chlorine gets reacted quickly, we get additional HCl, and then HCl can be. Or depending upon the concentration of caustic soda, we can first of all scrub with water, take total HCl, and then scrub with caustic and take care of the chlorine, where you will get NaCl. So excess chlorine, not only we are spending money at the inlet of the reactor, we are spending money at the outlet by reacting it with caustic. And caustic is very expensive. At that time, caustic was 1 rupee a kilo. Now the respective numbers now are, caustic is 32 rupees a kilo after these many years, and the chlorine is 2 rupees a kilo. Right? So those many changes are there. But the methodology, it remains the same. So what is the answer? The answer is, this is a philosophy, that if we have more excess, there will be more money required in terms of caustic, in terms of chlorine. All right. So what can be the decision? Suppose we keep only 1% excess. As per 1% excess, the partial pressure is 1% of total pressure multiplied by saturation solubility, and that will be the S star. So as we keep less excess, the rate of reaction is low, and as a result, the reactor size is going to increase. Right? So on one side, as we increase the, now all these statements, though very simple, my suggestion to all of you remember this, that everywhere money is hidden. And as an engineer, we need to find out. We need to find out where the money is hidden. And I give public lecture. Tomorrow I'm going to give lecture where there are 10 top industrialists of our country. And I'm going to make a public statement. If I have not visited your industry, 30% of your profit you are draining. This will be the first statement. Then they will listen very carefully. And I mean it. See what happens. You are a fresh engineer. I have started practicing from 1972. So calculate the number of years. It must be closer to 50. 47. Now I am able to select the reactor. I am able to select, decide the converter, the extent of conversion or the extent of excess, or what should be the conversion. If distillation column is there, then what is going to be the cost? And I can take much quicker decision. But as a fresh engineer, my advice is, take some excess. How does it matter? Take 5%, design the reactor, find out the cost of the reactor, find the annualized cost, find the raw material cost, and find the overall cost of production of benzyl chloride. Very simple. Take 10% excess, take 100% excess, right? It is anyway for calculation. And take 5% less also, 95% of the, and then try to find, and we call this as a parametric sensitivity, or sensitivity of each parameter on the cost of production, right? And then the decision is complete. So my suggestion to you is, how many rows are there? Array, normally there are 4 rows. I see only 2 rows. Let me divide. It seems to me 3 plus 3 and 3 plus 3, correct? So those 3 is group A and regime 1, regime 2, regime 3, and regime 4. Okay? I can give you the value of Henry's coefficient. I can give you the values of diffusivity. I can give you values of rate constant, etc. But I have told you that if you read salt example, then you understand nothing. If I solve this example on the board, now, definitely it is in some particular regime because we have done the experiments using model contactor, but now we want to understand the procedure. If required, the change name of chlorine and toluene to ozone and water, change the name to something and something, but you are in first regime, you are in second regime, you are in third regime, you are in fourth regime. But consider this example and try to see from the published literature what is the Henry's coefficient. And at 2% excess, atmospheric pressure, so 2% of atmosphere is the partial pressure multiplied by Henry's coefficient is S star. B naught, you take first of all 99% conversion, 1% is unreacted, calculate B naught. So A star is known, B naught is known, right? Then this rate constant is reported. Otherwise, what I can do for just faster, making it fast, for regime 1, I will give some numbers. But do costing and come up to the answer that which one is a good idea in terms of conversion, whether we should have not. How to calculate the cost of reactor, I explained you last time. No? Find the weight of the reactor and then I told you, no? So for all of you, take the value of, you are in regime 1. So M is 1, N is 1. Kmn is equal to first of all, let me tell you, B naught in, which is pure toluene, that kilomole per meter cube, you have to calculate. Similarly, outlet, whatever conversion you assume, whatever is unconverted, that B naught, you have to calculate. And B naught outlet is B naught everywhere in the reactor, right? So forget about B naught in. So B naught out and S star out, that is there everywhere. Okay, now take the value of Kmn is equal to 0.1 meter cube kilomole second. Activation energy is 20 kilocalories per gram mole degrees Kelvin. What else is required? Can calculate the rate and regime 2, take KLa is equal to, you will need Henry's coefficient, and the Henry's coefficient is 1 × 10⁻⁵. If I tell you the gram mole per cc atmosphere, you can convert it to kilomole per meter cube atmosphere. Yes. So gram mole per cc atmosphere. These data all of you can write. Value of KLa is 0.1 second inverse. So you are happy now. Correct. The third regime, diffusivity of A, that is chlorine, is 1 × 10⁻⁹ meter square per second. dA, dB is 0.7 × 10⁻⁹ meter square per second. You will get B naught and of course A star. I cannot give you randomly the value of Kmn because root m has to be greater than 3, correct? So you individually assume some value of Kmn in such a way that it falls in regime 3, all right? Are you getting me?
Yes.
Right. This is again simple. You know diffusivities, you know B naught outlet, you know S star outlet, you know how to calculate for instantaneous reactions, and individually you can get the rate. So try to understand the parametric sensitivity, effect of total pressure, effect of temperature, effect of extent of conversion with respect to liquid phase and extent of conversion with respect to gas phase, and find out the cost. Any difficulty? Any difficulty? You should tell me. What is not given, if it is in regime 3, interfacial area is not given. And if interfacial area is not given and KLa is given, then KL is not known. Therefore, you cannot calculate root m, right? So you need how to calculate A And you need to also calculate, on one side it is the equipment cost, but on the other side it is the operating cost of energy of running the impeller. And I think I have taught you the critical speed for gas dispersion. Correct? So the critical power required for gas dispersion, take the number of 2.5 kilowatts per meter cube. So suppose you get volume of dispersion as an answer is 20 meter cube. So 20 into 2.5, that is 50 kilowatt. And efficiency, there will be a motor, there is electrical efficiency. Then there is a transmission efficiency to gearbox and for gearbox to the shaft. So the overall efficiency is 80%. So that the motor required is 50 kilowatt divided by 0.8 and multiplied by electricity cost. What is the electricity cost these days per unit? 10 rupees, yeah. So assume that it runs for 8,000 hours a year and accordingly calculate the operating cost. And capital cost, I have already told you, calculate the weight of the reactor. So for interfacial area, and if it is in first regime, you did not ask what is value of epsilon L. Correct, no? So how to get epsilon L or how to get epsilon G so that 1 minus epsilon G is equal to epsilon L, how to get power consumption when we decide on the impeller diameter, impeller speed, does it work out to 2.5 kilowatt per ton per meter cube? So this procedure I am now again going to tell you with the help of artificial intelligence, all right? Last time you calculated power consumptions. I think that was the only exam where, and heat transfer coefficient also, and power consumption, only these two. And in the home assignment, there was heat transfer also or only power consumption? Array. Now today's exercise will be much more bigger exercise, I'll tell you. Heat of reaction, in this example, the chlorination of toluene, write down, 40 kilocalories plus 40 kilocalories per gram mole. So you'll have to design the heat transfer area also. So the home assignments that you have submitted, I'm returning them today with some reactions, right? So you can give the reactions, whatever are the. Marks have been given out of 10. Obviously, how many have submitted? Out of 30. And I see that today about, how many are present? But say, and this particular subject, third year people were also there at that time. Anyway, they were not there. So I'll teach them separately. Okay. So the basic principles of artificial intelligence I told you. Right? And now you will be taken further. Let these home assignments, you take it back. But you have not seen the parametric sensitivity over a wide range. That is, you were asked to vary the impeller diameter, impeller shape, that is impeller design, and the Reynolds number and tank diameter. You have taken small, small values. Dream big. Dream big. Think of earning 1,000 crores per year. Then only you can design bigger reactors. You have taken 30 centimeter, you will get 5 rupees per month. So take sizable reactors, use the values and be, of course, now today we are more specific. that for the regime 1, regime 2, regime 3, regime 4, there will be specific volumes. But having obtained the, initially what we do, we don't know interfacial area. We don't know interfacial area. We don't know KL. We don't know hold up. But how to start? The artificial intelligence, as you have put in the data, it needs vessel diameter, it needs vessel height, it needs impeller design, impeller dimensions, the locations. We still don't know the, what is the reactor volume, how to give these values. Correct, no? So therefore, what we do is, we give interfacial area, typically for stirred tanks, it is in the range of 40 to 200 meter square per meter cube. General range, 40 to 200 meter square per meter cube. So you start with some number. You start with some number. Then you will get dimensions. With those dimensions, you ask artificial intelligence the value of hold up, the value of mass, the value of interfacial area, and power consumption, and value of power consumption. And then you again find the dimensions. You may have to iterate a couple of times, three times, four times, and then you will get the answer. So now let us take one example right here for the determination of hold up and power consumption and interfacial area. Okay? So you know your, what is that password or something? So login, login yourself. It seems to me that, today I will give you value of interfacial area. Only today you can calculate power consumption, right? In presence, in absence of gas that you did last time, and in presence of gas. And on the basis of power consumption, I will give you correlations for finding interfacial area and KL. Is that okay? Right. Okay then. You log in. Are most of the faces are blank?
Yes,
locked in. So put some vessel diameter, vessel height, whatever are the, put everything. You do lot of practice, lot of practice. You will get order of magnitude. Now, personally, I'm now right at a condition. You tell me 50 tons per day, I'll quickly give you what is the reactor design. You give me the problem, within 1 minute, I'll give you the answer. This is because I have done more than 1,000 number of times. So if you do 1,000 number of times, you retire J.B. Joshi as soon as possible. This is the only way. Keep on doing and keep on understanding the sensitivity of any parameter on profit. So whatever data have been asked, can they get power consumption? Yeah, okay. In such a way that power consumption is at least 2.5 kilowatt per meter cube, correct? Then calculate the cost of the reactor, calculate annualized cost, calculate power cost, right? And then see whether there should be 1% excess, 5% excess, 2% excess. You keep on calculating, okay? And submit it next time. Each and everybody, you must have realized that doing oneself, it is not difficult. The difficulty because you have been doing for the first time, right? So this first time should not remain next time. Right? So you should solve. So who is not going to submit home assignment? I'll get it corrected. Today you got your answer, your earlier answer book. Marks have been given. Are you distribute? Who is your monitor? MK means monitor. Huh? You got it? Then PLDs. PLD monitor. PLD monitor is not there. Aditi is the monitor. So give to Aditi. You have given? That is for masters. Are today final year students are also there, no? So who is final year monitor? Are let me force monitorship. You are the monitor, yeah. So have you been sorted out? Masters and bachelors have been sorted out? So you submit, today is what, Friday, no? Monday you submit. Okay? You are responsible. And MK means? Yeah, but who is the monitor? Yeah, so you collect from everybody. I don't mind if you type it and send soft copy to him, I don't mind. Type it and send it to him so that it will be easy. But whatever is the methodology is okay with me. But I'm going to engage you a few more times till I see on your face some confidence. Right?